Welcome to the lecture series on EC354 microprocessors. In the previous lectures, we have gone through the basics or the introduction of the microprocessor, and we have seen how exactly the microprocessor works and a very basic part of the memory that we had covered. From today's lecture, we are going for the internal architecture of 8085 microprocessor. Okay. So, in the internal architecture of 8085 microprocessor, we are going for an 8085 block diagram first. We will start with the 8085 microprocessor block diagram. So we can see what is exactly inside the microprocessor chip, and we will learn the exact working of the 8085 microprocessor. So whenever we go for the working of a particular instruction, we will use this internal architecture to explain the same. Okay. So in the 8085 block diagram, as in the previous lecture, we had seen that there are three buses, that is the address bus, data bus, control bus. Okay. So the first block that we are supposed to start with, the first block that we will start, that is the address buffer. That is the address buffer that will be of 8 bits, and along with that we are having a data or address buffer that is of 8 bit. Okay, so basically the address buffer comprising of, that is the higher order address bus that we are having, that is A15 to A8. That is the address bus we are having, and the lower order address and data bus is a multiplexed one. So we are having AD7 to AD0. So from this we can see that initially we are having an address buffer. We are having an address buffer, and we are having data or address buffer. Okay, so in this we are having A15 to A8, that is the higher order address bus. As far as the lower order address bus is concerned, the lower order address bus is the multiplexed one. Okay, means the same lines share the lower order address as well as data. Okay, so that is our AD7 to AD0. So these are the address and data bus buffers where initially the address and data is being taken from the peripherals. Now see that the next block that we are having, that is connected with address bus like this, okay, and we do have an internal 8-bit data bus. So I am drawing over here an internal 8-bit data bus. That is the internal 8-bit data bus. Okay, so that internal 8-bit data bus is also being connected to the data bus. Okay, so this is how the connections are actually being made. Now this block that I have drawn is a register array block, is a register array block. Now this block comprising of the registers that we use, which are inside the 8085 microprocessor. So we are having, let us list the registers which are there in 8085. So we are having some general purpose registers which we can use for the temporary storage of data while we write the program. So initially we are having a B register that is of 8 bits, a C register that is of 8 bit, in the same way a D register that is of 8 bit, a E register that is of 8 bit, H register that is of 8 bit, and L register of 8 bit. Okay, so we do have some general purpose registers. Okay, so we are having a B register, C register, so we are having BC register. Okay, we do have B register that is of 8 bit, C register, D, E, H, L. Okay, now in some cases they are being collectively used as an 16 bit register. Okay, so collectively they can be used as a 16 bit register. So for a 16 bit register, the pairs are being made, that is of high 8 bits and a low 8 bit. So for this, as shown in the architecture, the pairs which are being possible, which are being made, are BC can work together as a 16 bit register. Then we are having DE which can work as a 16 bit register, HL which will work as a 16 bit register. But keep in mind that this part will work as a high byte and the right side part will work as the low byte. Okay, so the possible pairs are BC, DE and HL. They can work as a 16 bit register. And in instructions, when we see that while we are using a 16 bit register in the operand field of an instruction, then instead of writing, like for an example, if we are going for LXIH, so we will not write LXIHL, we will write only LXIH comma the 16 bit of address or data that we want to store. Okay, that is the 16 bit of data that will come in LXIH. Is it clear? So when we are using a pair, we are supposed to use the higher byte. Means if we are using a BC pair, then only B we are supposed to write in the operand field. If we are using the DE pair, then the D will be written in the operand field. If we are using the HL pair, then the H will be written in the operand field. Okay. There is one more thing. When we communicate with memory, then there is one more thing that we need to learn, is the M. Many instructions will comprising of M. So whenever you see M in the operand field, it suggests that it is a memory pointer pointed by HL pair. Okay, so to use M, we need to initialize the HL pair first. So the contents of the HL pair will work as the memory location whenever you write this M in the operand field of an instruction. So for an example, when I write move A comma M, means the data from memory that is M, is to be transferred into accumulator or copied into accumulator when we are going for a move instruction. So in that case, the value of M will be, you can always remember this, that M is a memory pointer pointed by HL pair. So HL pair is supposed to be initialized first. So once the HL pair is initialized, only then you can go for M. Okay, so M is nothing but the memory pointer pointed by HL pair. Okay. Now see that. So these are the pairs that we have seen, that is B, C, D, E, H, L. There are two memory pointers we have in 8085, that is SP and PC, that is of 16 bits each. So we do have 16 bit registers in 8085, and then we are having increment or decrement address latch. Increment or decrement address latch. Now see that in 8085 we are having two 16 bit registers, that is stack pointer and program counter. These two are the memory pointers. Now the program counter is a 16 bit register which stores the memory location address from where the next opcode is to be fetched. That is the definition of a program counter. Means it will work as a memory pointer, okay, from where the next opcode is to be fetched. Okay, so in 8085, as the memory locations are of 16 bit, so it is a 16 bit register. Okay, on the other hand, stack pointer is a 16 bit register which points to the stack area. So it will point to the very first location of the stack area. Okay, so these two are the memory pointers. Stack pointer points to the stack area, that is nothing but the part of the RAM which is being used for the temporary storage of data. Okay, and the block diagram, the last block in the register array, we are having increment or decrement address latch. So because of this increment or decrement address latch, program counter is auto incremented by 1 every time when the opcode fetch operation is being done. Okay, so every time when the opcode is fetched, the program counter is incremented by 1. Okay, that is being done by increment or decrement address latch, and this block is connected to the internal 8 bit data bus. Okay, so all the registers are being connected to the 8 bit data bus or the system bus, you can say. Okay, now see that in many cases there are few hidden registers also which are not being accessible to the program. There are few hidden registers. So all these registers are being available to the programmer, okay, but in the register array inside the 8085 microprocessor there are two hidden registers, like we are having our W register and Z register. These two registers are being used when in the operand field we are having 16 bit of address, like we are having call instruction or jump instruction, where there is a 16 bit of address in the operand field. So to store that address temporarily, there are two hidden registers in 8085 microprocessor, okay, and they are, that is the W register and the Z register. So these are the two registers which are not available to the programmer, but they will work internally for the proper working of the call instructions or the jump instructions or the instructions which comprising 16 bit of address in the operand. Okay, so let us proceed further in the block diagram. Okay, so we have gone through these two things, that is the address buffer, and we had gone through the register array. Okay, so after this, let us proceed further in the block diagram, and let us start with the other registers that we have. Okay, so in 8085, we do have an accumulator register, that is the A register of 8 bits. There is an accumulator register, that is the A register of 8 bit. As the name suggests, accumulator. So in 8085 microprocessor, the architecture is like that most of the instructions, the final result is being accumulated in the accumulator. That's why the name is being given as accumulator. So in most of the microprocessors, there are instructions in which the final result will be stored in accumulator. Okay, that's why the name is being given accumulator. And this is the one of the registers which are always involved in arithmetic and logical instructions. So it is one of the part of arithmetic and logical instruction that we will see how internally it will work in the block diagram. So we are having accumulator register A. Along with accumulator register A, we do have one temporary register also. We do have temporary register of 8 bits. And the microprocessor is comprising of an arithmetic and logic unit which can perform only 8 bit of operations at a time. This is how it is being connected. This is how the blocks are being connected with each other. So in 8085 microprocessor, we do have an ALU, that is an arithmetic and logic unit, to perform the arithmetic and logical operations. Okay, now the one input to the arithmetic and logical unit is always an accumulator. So most of the instructions, like when we write add B, so in that, what it will do? It will do A plus that B will come from the register array, and that will be stored in the temporary register first. So we are doing A plus B in add B instruction. Okay, when we are going for some arithmetic instructions like addition. And the final result is again going to be stored in A. So keep in mind, in all arithmetic and logical operations, the accumulator is the one operand and the final result is always going to be stored in the accumulator. Okay, that is because of the internal architecture of the microprocessor. So when you go through the instruction set and when you are learning the arithmetic and logic unit, you will find that one operand is always accumulator and the final result is again stored in the accumulator. So this is because of the internal architecture of the 8085 microprocessor. Now, so the one input will be A register, the other will be the temp register that can be taken from any other 8 bit register of the 8085 microprocessor. Now, while doing the arithmetic and logical operations, there are few flags, or there is a flag register, or we can say flag flip-flops are there, which will be set and reset depending on the instructions which are being executed by arithmetic and logic unit. So there is a concept of flag register in 8085 microprocessor. Now this flag register is an 8-bit register, and it represents the particular condition which is being met while performing arithmetic and logical operations. So basically, when a microprocessor performs a task, many times it may happen that if we perform an addition, then when the carry is being generated, how to tackle that carry? If there is a addition and the result is zero in the accumulator, okay, so what is the reason behind that? So how to find out, okay, that if the final result is zero, it means if some particular condition is being met, there is a facility inside the 8085 microprocessor that particular flag will be raised or not raised, or if it is set or not set. Is it clear? Or it is at logic 1 or logic 0. So that is the case of the flag register. So let us go in detail regarding the 8085 flag register. So we do have 5 flags in 8085, and if I draw the 8-bit, if I draw the whole 8-bit, that is from the bit D0 to bit D7 of that particular flag register, okay? So we are having total 5 flags in 8085 microprocessor. So let us go with the flags one by one, okay? So the first flag that we are having in the D0 bit is the carry flag. The first flag that we are having, that is the D0th bit of the 8-bit flag register, is the carry flag. So whenever we do an 8-bit addition or subtraction and there is a carry from the D7th bit coming out, then the carry flag will be set. Okay, so when the carry flag will set, when there is a carry out from the D7th bit while performing an arithmetic and logical operations, okay, so it will check the 8-bit data limit. So whenever you perform an arithmetic and logical operation, and if there is an overflow, means if the microprocessor is crossing the 8-bit limit, or whatever the final result is above 8 bits, okay, then the carry flag will be set in the flag register. Okay, set means logic 1, not set means logic 0. Then the D2 bit, okay, let us first go with the D4 bit. The D4 bit is auxiliary carry. So whenever there is a carry from D3 bit to D4 bit while we perform an addition, for an example, and if there is a carry from the D3 bit to D4 bit, means we are checking the limit for a nibble, means 4 bits. So if there is a carry from D3 bit to D4 bit while performing an addition or any other arithmetic and logical operation, then auxiliary carry flag will be set. Okay, so that is the auxiliary carry flag. After auxiliary carry flag, we are having a 0 flag. So when the arithmetic and logic unit results in a 0 in the accumulator, then the 0 flag will be set. Means if the final result which is to be stored in the accumulator is 0 after performing some arithmetic and logical function, then the zero flag will be set. In all other cases it is not set. Okay, then the D7th bit is the sign bit, so it will check the D7th bit of the accumulator. After any arithmetic or logical instructions, the microprocessor will check the D7th bit of the accumulator. If that is 1, then the sign flag is 1. If that is 0, then the sign flag will be 0. Okay, so this is the sign bit. And finally, we are having the D2 bit, that is the parity bit. Okay, now for parity, it will check the number of logic ones, means the contents of after any arithmetic and logical instruction, the microprocessor will check the contents of accumulator. What it will check? It will check how many ones are there, logic ones are there in the accumulator. For an example, if in the accumulator we are having 0, 2H, then how many ones are there? There will be only one. So it is an odd parity. So keep in mind, for odd parity, parity flag is 0 in 8085 microprocessor. For even parity, like for an example, if we are having 5, 0, 5 in accumulator, then 5 is how much? 0 is how much? 0, 0, 0, 0, and 5 is how much? 0, 1, 0, 1. Okay, so there are only 2 ones, so it will be an even parity. For even parity, the parity bit will be at logic 1. Okay, so for even parity it is 1, for odd parity it is 0. Okay, so that is all about the flag register of 8085 microprocessor. Later on, when we discuss the 8085 instruction set, we will see that which are the instructions which will affect these flags or the flag register. Okay, so let us proceed further in the block diagram. So arithmetic and logic unit part is over. So after arithmetic and logic part, the next part that we are supposed to learn, that we are having, is an instruction register. We are having an instruction register of 8 bits. Now, as the name suggests, instruction register, this instruction register stores the current instruction opcode which is executed by the microprocessor. So the instruction which is currently executed by the microprocessor, its opcode is stored in the instruction register. Okay, so that is of 8 bit, and that is being given to, that is being given to instruction decoder, that is being given to instruction decoder, and machine cycle encoding. So whatever the time which is being taken by that particular instruction, okay, that is being done in the machine cycle encoding part, and the instruction opcode is being decoded by this instruction decoder. Okay, and that is being given to the final block, that is the timing and control block, to provide timing and control for the execution of that particular instruction. So that is being given to the timing and control block. Okay, so this is comprising of some signals like clock, then we are having some general signals, general control signals. Okay, we are having some control status signals, we are having DMA signals in that, and we do have some reset signals also. Okay, we will see all these signals in detail when we go for the pinout diagram in the next lecture. Okay, so currently I am just giving you an overview regarding the timing and control block. That we are having the clock signals, some clock generator circuitry inside the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, we do have some control status signals, we do have direct memory access signals, reset signals and all that. Okay, so that is the timing and control block. Okay, so this part we will see in detail when we go for the pinout diagram in the next lecture. Okay, so this is the 8085 internal architecture. Okay, by using this you can explain how exactly it is working. Okay, there are two more blocks, okay, which will add the capability of the 8085 microprocessor. So let us go with the first block that is connected to the 8-bit internal data bus. The first block is a serial IO block. You can write serial IO control, that is comprising of SOR and SID pins. That is serial output data and serial input data. So in 8085 microprocessor, there is a facility to send the serial data and to receive the serial data. Okay, so we are having serial output data and serial input data. Okay, this we will see when we see the instruction set in more detail. Okay, so we are having a serial IO control with two pins, serial output data and serial input data. Okay, the last block that we have in the 8085 microprocessor is the interrupt block. We are having the interrupt block. Okay, so we are having interrupt control block. Okay, so for interrupt control block we are having the interrupts like INTR. Along with INTR we are having INTA, and then we are having restart interrupts. So restart interrupt we are having RST 5.5, we are having RST 6.5, we are having RST 7.5, and we are having a trap. So they are basically, it is trap, not trap, it is trap. Okay, so we are having basically four interrupt sources in 8085 microprocessor. Basically we are having these four interrupt sources. Okay, so if we go for the priority wise, then we are having trap as the highest priority, then RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, and then the INTR. Okay, so we do have the interrupt facility in 8085 microprocessor. Now see that while we write a program for an 8085 microprocessor to make a system, then there are two types of programming that can be done. Okay, so the program can be written in an interrupt driven way, or it can be written in a polling way. Okay, so basically to do a proper multitasking, people will go with interrupt driven program. Okay, that is the efficient way to write the programming. For an example, if we are supposed to write a program to monitor 5 IO devices And whenever the service request is there, the individual device is being given the service, and then it will again come back to the original program. Okay? In the polling method, the main program individually checks the IO device one by one. Okay? So there is a sequence of checking which is being done in the main program. So one by one it will check the IO device. If the service is required, it will provide the service. Okay? But what will happen if it is checking the third device and at the same time the first device is asking for the service? So in a sequence, when it will reach to the first device, the request is gone. Okay? So in many cases, delays are being used to overcome that. But the efficient way to write a program for a multitasking system is the interrupt driven. So the main program is written in an infinite loop. So whenever a device wants service from the microprocessor, it gives an interrupt to the microprocessor. Okay? We will see this concept in more detail when we go for the interrupt controller, which is being connected to the 8085 microprocessor. Okay? We will see that in much more detail. Okay? So currently we are having four sources. We are having interrupt request, restart interrupts, and we are having trap. Okay? Out of these interrupts, trap is a non-maskable interrupt. So basically, there are two types of interrupts. The first one is a maskable interrupt, and the second one is non-maskable interrupts. So trap, as I said, is a non-maskable interrupt. So when I say it is a non-maskable interrupt, means it cannot be masked. Mask means it cannot be stopped. Okay? So whenever there is a trap, there is an interrupt on the trap pin, it is not to be masked by the 8085 microprocessor. So it is always serviced by the 8085 microprocessor. So it is a non-maskable interrupt. The restart interrupts and the INTR, they are maskable interrupts. So by using the software, we can do the masking. Means we are supposed to provide the service to it, or we are not supposed to provide the service to it. We can write the code for that. Okay? So using a software, it can be masked. Okay? So they are masked interrupts. So we are having non-maskable and maskable interrupts. Okay? That is the first case. The second case is that we do have vectored interrupts and non-vectored interrupts. Okay? So out of all this, INTR is a non-vector interrupt. Rest of the interrupts are vector interrupts. Means whenever an interrupt occurs, the program execution will stop and that particular interrupt is being serviced. So how it is serviced? So an interrupt service routine is being written in the memory. If the jump address is already fixed by the manufacturer or by the internal architecture, okay, then it will be a vectored interrupt. So there is always an interrupt vector table given by the manufacturer that if this interrupt will come, where the program execution will start. Okay? So there is a concept of interrupt vector table, IVT, in the microprocessors. So whenever the interrupt will come, on that address the execution will start. Okay? So if that is already being decided by the manufacturer and given in the interrupt vector table, then they are being called as vectored interrupt. Okay? And if that is being decided by the programmer by adding some hardware in case of INTR, okay, so by using the hardware and giving a call instruction, the address can be defined for the interrupt service routine. Okay, so that will came under a non-vector interrupt. Okay, so we had seen regarding the interrupt that it can be maskable, it can be non-maskable, can be vectored, it can be non-vectored. Okay, we had also seen the priorities, that trap is having the highest priority among all the interrupts. if we talk about only restart interrupts, then in restart interrupts, RST 7.5 is having the highest priority. And INTR, that is the interrupt request, is having the lowest priority. Okay? So, that's all we have for today's lecture. So, in today's lecture, we have gone through the internal architecture of 8085 microprocessor in detail, and we have gone through the block diagram. So, in next lecture, we will start with the pinout diagram. We will see the pinout diagram of the 8085 microprocessor, and we will see the functioning of all the pins in detail, which will complete the timing and control part as far as the other signals are concerned. Okay, so thank you very much.